Welcome to the Group B match coming up between the seeded athlete Line Karsfeldt of Denmark against Sonia Goncalves of Portugal. Umpire. Line Karsfeldt, who is certainly the favourite in this bout. She's already won her two matches in superb style coming through here. And Sonia Goncalves has won one and lost one. And this is a serious challenge for her against the Danish opponent, who's not the top ranked Dane in women's singles. Of course, Denmark have a great heritage in women's badminton going back many, many years. I remember not so long ago, of course, Camilla Martin was the big draw for Danish badminton. But so far, Line Karsfeldt is looking quite comfortable here, but it's early days. We've seen that one goes out from Condola. She's gonna challenge this one. While the challenge is happening, chance to just run you through the results so far. Karsfeldt already beat Milica Simic of Serbia 21-7, 21-10. And the Spanish athlete Clara Azumendi 21-6, 21-12. So she has not had a tough time at all. 7 and 6 points conceded in her first games. We're just waiting for the replay to come up on screen. As for Sonia Goncalves, she lost to the Spaniard Azumendi, 21-16, 21-10. That was in. That's a great challenge.
Service over, 1-2, black.
And but she lost. So she lost that one to the Spanish athlete, and then she beat Simic of Serbia 21-16, 21-15. So the strange situation we've got here is a victory for Portugal would see a three-way tie at the top, and then everybody starts getting the calculators out. So if things start looking as if they're going Portugal's way, and of course that's a very big if, especially with a shot like that that came off the edge of the racket, then I will guide you through the calculations, and I'll get my pen and paper out and start adding up games for and against and points, etc. But currently this one, the Danish athlete looking very strong here, isn't she? This is a very strong start. Five-two ahead very early on. Karsfeldt, of course, top two go through. So at the moment, looking like Karsfeldt and Azumendi, who will be the athletes that going through. Line Karsfeldt, ranked number 36 in the world. Represented Denmark in the Sudirman Cup. Just about 5 weeks ago. She was very busy. Faced some of the top athletes in the tournament there. Goncalves obviously having trouble here. She's talking to herself quite seriously. Karsfeldt is based out of Aarhus. She actually started playing when she was 8 years old in Aarhus. Her best ranking is 34. And she has been ranked at 51 in women's doubles. That one is on the line.
Service over, 4-9.
But she's really concentrating on her singles at the moment. Her current doubles ranking, her best doubles ranking right now is over 900. So she's not playing doubles at all seriously, concentrating solely on her singles career. She's going well. If you're ranked in the top for the singles competition, is very, very tough. And of course, Asia dominate. Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, China, Japan have very strong athletes. And at the moment, Giancarlo's is not really pushing our opponent at all here. There are eight groups in the women's singles category, just like the men's. Top two from each group go through. So they basically play this round robin, the top two go through. It's just an opportunity, I think, for the players to play themselves in on this court. In effect, we go from eight groups of four, so we go from 32 players down to 16. So they could have just played one round of matches, but it's a chance for everybody to play in. And Karsfeldt there 12-4. Is totally dominant at the moment. She's not even been stretched and still winning point after point. Remember, it was 3-all earlier on. So she has won 9 out of the last 10 points. That will give Giancarlo's a bit of a boost. But I think this game's already going to be lost. It's the Portuguese athlete who, just to reiterate that, puts a serve well into the net. It wasn't even close to the top. She's obviously not in a great place at the moment. Well, Karsfeldt's just almost playing training shots here at the moment. Out.
15-5.
Yeah, that was a lovely shot from Karsfeldt there. 16. Just corner to corner. And I think she's already realized if she can just play those standard shots. This is the world number 36 after all. She's at the top of her game.
6-16. Service over 17-6.
This is good. At least Giancarlo's is getting a bit of rallying done here.
18-6.
She still loses a point, but she was able to rally there.
Service over. 7-18.
And here you have the difference between an athlete who doesn't really play on the world tour. She's good locally, she's competitive at national level. But as possibly aware, there's a massive difference between national and international badminton. Well, she's still very young, Giancarlo's, only 20 years old. She actually won the European Junior Championship in 2013. Ah, Karsfeldt just made that look so easy. She's not even breaking into a sweat. And that one right on the line. And at the moment, things are not going well at all for Sonia Goncalves. 21-7, first game. And the European Junior Champion from 2013 has got it all to do. Well, Sonia Goncalves here, probably saying her goodbye to the event here. A defeat will put her in third place. Simic will finish fourth. A victory here will certainly mix things up a little bit, but that certainly doesn't look as if it's going to happen. Second game. 21 years old, Lina Karsfeld. Only 5'5". According to the database I have in front of me, I'm actually not sure if I believe that. She looks quite a bit taller than that. Goncalves is listed as 5'9". I think they're both about a similar height to my reckoning. Goncalves is at least working her opponent around a little bit there, but poor execution of that backhand, just trying to lob it over the net, but into the net. Well, Lina Karsfeld has been amazing. Her first games in this tournament, against Simic it was 21-7, against Azurmendi it was 21-6, and here it was 21-7. So in the three games that she's played, the three first games she's played, she's not conceded enough points to actually lose a single game. Just 20 points in those three. So she's obviously in a pretty confident mood, and certainly there'll be nobody fancying meeting Karsfeld in the knockout section. There are a number of unbeaten players throughout all the groups. Of course, Denmark is probably the one nation in Europe that has a real heritage. Great Britain haven't sent a team. Karsfeld puts the big smash in on the back of the court. Now there's a shot from Goncalves, but Karsfeld just returns it back and just to demoralize even more, plants the next one bang on the line. Well, this, you really feel sorry for the Portuguese girl. She's going through a tough time here. She's been outclassed. And it's, well, it's only the odd couple of mistakes here from Karsfeld. She puts that one out of court. Ah, too easy. And Goncalves doesn't even go for it. First game was 9 minutes long. Longest rally so far, 20 strokes, which isn't a lot. It's a fair number, but we're usually seeing, in terms of the longest rally in the match, Karsfeld lets that one go. Usually you see a 30 or 40 shot rally. In fact, we had an 88 shot rally early on in the tournament, which was getting towards a record-breaking number. I think the record is over 120. I I can't remember the exact number of strokes, but 88 is very high. Well, you feel Karlsfeld is just trying to get herself going a little bit here. The danger for her is that her next match will be a really tough match against another opponent who'll have qualified from another group. And she's winning points really without having to do anything of any note. And you almost feel that she's trying to raise her own game a little bit here. That one looks as if it was bang on the line. I don't think this challenge will work. But you almost feel that, look on the TV, that's bang on the line. But you almost feel that Karlsfeld is just trying to get a bit of momentum going, just to feel as if she's in a proper big match. There you see.
Challenge unsuccessful. Sonia Gonsalves has one challenge remaining. Service over, 8-6, play.
Well, that was a pretty wasted challenge. I think Karlsfeld know that as well.
9-6.
Well, that all shot. The Danish athlete puts the serve up long. Goncalves jumps high, smashes it down. I think Karlsfeld was almost a little bit surprised. Well, that's off the edge of the racket, and that'll be an easy put away.
Service over, 10-7.
That's not the first one that Goncalves has hit off the edge of the racket at all. She's really not on her game. I'm sure she'd have played better than this and that when winning the European Juniors. Now that's the shot, that's more like it. Karlsfeld's not just playing very loose shots herself. This match is going to be over very shortly indeed, and it's just one of those which is quite a mismatch. You see, Karlsfeld just playing the previous shot was a very strange one. She almost didn't have the energy to put it away.
Tens de fazer interseções, mas se a tua raquete está em baixo, não consegues fazer interseções. Se a raquete está em cima, tu já salta, já bloqueias, já podes fazer um batimento forte para o fundo. Agora, corriges no fundo a tua movimentação para chegares a tempo. Fica sempre curto, só gera. E tens que atacar mais. A oportunidade de atacar, ataca.
Well, Goncalves getting a few harsh words with her coach. I don't think he needs a hope of hopes that he would have expected a victory, but he may have well have expected a better performance from his athlete, because she really has not turned out in this match at all. And that's better. Well, maybe a little roasting from your coach does get the heartbeat going a little bit, because that was a much better shot. That was a rally. She gave Karlsfeld a good time, but that's not such a good serve. Karlsfeld can put those away all day.
12-9.
Yes. Need to really go short on those. But the trouble is, when she goes short, Karlsfeld ties her up in knots. Well, that was strange. You don't see somebody who's as highly ranked as Karlsfeld doing this. Here we go. She's going to come in with a backhand and totally misses the shuttle. That's very unusual. 12-10 in Gonzalez. Goncalves is 12-11. Well, hello. A few words from the coach, and suddenly a few points, and we have a game on here. Sonia Goncalves has completely not been at this game whatsoever, and somehow she's only 1 point behind. And that's out. And we've got a tied game at 12 all. Well, whatever that coach said, he needs to write it down and use that for future occasions, because something he said has made his player suddenly pick up her game. Asphalt plays a lovely drop there. Totally wrong foot, Skarnkalis. So 13-12. Just gone a little bit messy from the Danish athlete. That one's out. Skarnkalis wants to change the shuttle. She'll blame the shuttle for that return of serve. You heard the call there. Sonia talking to herself a little bit there. She got herself into a good position, but that's two mistakes that she's made in a row. Just needless errors. Cosfeld just can't believe that. She's been hitting a few long, and I've got a feeling that she took a little bit out of that shot, and it still went long. And that's why the look of incredulity on her face there. Again, the drop shot doing all the damage there, isn't it? Every time Goncalves has to go to the front. And that's right in the corner. No getting that one back.
Service over. 16-30.
Drop shot has been key here for Karsfeld. Goncalves comes in. She just doesn't have the speed of movement to get in, get out. And there, a superb 30. Cross court. And I think Goncalves hasn't even worked out which side of the court she's supposed to receive on. I think she just can't wait to get off this court and get back into the changing rooms and go back to her hotel room, probably. She certainly won't want to watch this video again, because it's a bit of a horror story for her. She got back to 12 all, but you feel that Karsfeld now has just gone back to her bread and butter shot. She's not doing anything particularly special, but she is being quite ruthless out there, and she's doing what is needed to win points. And that shot again. Goncalves cannot read that shot whatsoever. Here we go. That's something she'll have to work on, because that wasn't even close to the line. That was well in.
20 match
points. Well, remember, it was 12 all. So 8 of the last 9 points has gone to Karsfeld, and after not a lot of time at all, only 20 minutes on the clock, it's 7 match points for Karsfeld. She takes it the first attempt, and the Danish player is through to the knockout stage. She wins her group, and she will progress through as a group leader. She'll get a slightly easier draw. And Sonia Goncalves will depart these first European Games. She's got one victory under her belt, but she won't be happy with the way that she played in that final match. Comprehensive victory for the world number 36, who will be eyeing up a medal later on in the week. Lena Karsfeld wins 21-7, 21-13. So, getting ready for a Group A women's singles match here. Lara Sarosi from Hungary and Maria Ulitina of Ukraine. Sarosi, 22 years old. 5'6", and Ulitina, 23 years old, 5'10", so a little bit taller. Ukrainian athlete Sarosi. This is a Group A match, and And this is one that matters. Both these athletes have won one match each. They've lost one match also. And so this is almost like a knockout match. Whoever wins this will progress through to the knockout stage. Simple as that. So far, not a good start for Shirose. Putting that one straight out of play. This is a Group A match. The group will be won by the Bulgarian Linda Zachiri, who's already won all her three matches comfortably.
Service over. 4-1.
Shirose lost to her 21-13, 21-7. And Ulitina lost to her 21-11, 21-16. So fairly similar scores there. All the athletes have beaten the other athlete that's in this pool, Veronika Grudzina. Shirose took three games to win in her match. So just from that little, Ulitina won 21-18, 21-18. So two games to love. But it's fair to say that there is possibly a leaning, just looking at the scores, that the Ukrainian could be slight favourite. And obviously seeing 6-1 here in game one is a good start for Ulitina. First to 21 points in each game. It's the best of three games. And two clear points. Two quite young athletes out there. Good rally. Maria Ulitina, world rank number 64. So somebody who has played on the world tour on a regular basis. Lara Shirose is world ranked number 95. Of course, a lot of the athletes do travel around a lot. I was just looking at some of the events that Shirose has played this year on the World Tour. She beat to Estonia, Sweden, Uganda, Romania, Peru, Chile, Slovenia, and St. Domingo. So she's certainly been collecting the air miles. And here she is in Azerbaijan, trying to work her way up the world rankings. Well, it's not been a good start for her. She's been doing a bit of walkabout on court as well, because Ulitina has romped away to an 11-3 start here. Very interesting to hear the Hungarian coach there. Obviously, he's not Hungarian national, so they're using English as the language, but he's I think he's just been quite clear there that Shirose is just not playing her game, and she's a little bit too worried about her opponent in this match. And sometimes he's playing quite slow shots and giving her opponent plenty of time to get round and play them. So it'll be interesting to see if that little chit chat she had with her coach will make any difference. Tina grimaces there as that one hits the net, but oh my goodness, well that's probably that is really a giveaway point. That's probably the biggest error I think I've seen. She was absolutely on top of the net. She looks up to the heavens, can't believe that she's not put that one over. She built up a strong position, and then right from on top of the net she just netted again. Ah, that's more like it. I know Latina back just getting back into some of her default methods of playing. She's obviously one that likes to play corners. A little run of points there for Shirose, 22-year-old. Well, I think the Hungarian coach won't be happy at all with that. She's just playing. In fact, she turns around and has a quick word. He's obviously quite concerned there that she was, just loose shots there, and it's too easy for Litina at the moment. 13-6. This is better from Shirose. She's working hard, and Litina pulls in a tremendous cross court. Well, after all the attack from Shirose, Olutina plays one attacking move and it's good enough to win the point. See, Shirose's got quite a strapping on her right leg. I don't know if she's feeling a bit weak on court. She seems to be a little bit slow at times on the defense. Olutina seems to be just finding it a little bit too easy. When she's attacking, she scores the points that Shirose is not really challenging at all. And Olutina again goes to the back. 16-6. Well, at the moment, there's just one formula for Olutina. Hit it long. This is like me playing in the church hall. One trick pony I am. Hit it long. And then as soon as your opponent just pops one up, you're all over it. Well, that was better play from Shirose. This time it was at the front of the net, and she looks good there. That was a lovely shot she played. That was a winner, straight winner from her racket. Well, I don't think Shirose's coach will be pleased at all to see his player just feed Olutina on her favorite shot that she must have accumulated maybe 12 points, maybe more in this game. That's what Olutina wants. She wants the high ones at the back because she does that time and time again. 18-7. This is a great play from Olutina. She's going to be a force if she gets through to the knockout stage. Remember, the winner of this match, he's through to the knockout stage. Olutina, if it is her, and she's looking very strong at the moment, has another one. She's firing them in from all angles. Got to admit, if Olutina wins this, she'll finish second in her group. And I've got to say, there's going to be a few players who are winning their groups around this Baku Sports Hall. We may have just got a little crafty eye on her. I might be thinking, I just hope I don't draw her when the knockout draws produced, because Olutina is firing. And after not a lot of time at all, She's got game points. Just 10 minutes on the board. Just a slight miss it there, you just heard that. Slight edge of the racket. The contact wasn't right. But Oletina won't be worried at all because the Ukrainian has got points galore here. She can afford to make several errors and still have plenty more to go. Still 11 more game points here for Oletina. She's not even running, not even running full pace to that shot, and that's in. That wasn't close, and Oletina wins that first match. I'm not sure the coaches even want to get up because there's, what do you tell her? She's absolutely dominating this match. Of course, she wins the first game. Me and my terminology. She could well be winning the match, though, because she won that game so comfortably that Sarosi really has something to pull out here in game number two if she's going to be even close. 21 points to 9. And it wasn't close. 11 minutes. And Maria Oletina has got half a foot, could you say, in the knockout section? I'm not sure what exactly they said, of course, but to be honest, you could probably guess that it's just keep doing the same. She's obviously, Sarosi is struggling a lot at the back of the court. She's looking a little bit flustered there, isn't she? Her coach is talking to her. But the trouble is, if Sarosi just doesn't have the ammunition to challenge, and I've got a feeling it's going to be a bit of a latter. I'm not sure any amount of coaching will help Lara Sarosi here at all. Well, we start the same second game with a new shuttle. The longest rally in that first game, 19 shots. Not a lot. In fact, they didn't change shuttle all the way through that first game, which is incredible, really. Here's Sarosi having a real go. Oletina goes to the back, and again, Sarosi has trouble. And the first point goes to Ukraine.
Service over.
1-0. Lovely play at the front of the court.
2-1.
This match is being dominated by the Ukrainian here. Much a do-or-die moment now for Sarosi, the Hungarian. I really love Oletina's movement. She moves around the court so well. And there she makes a bit of a mistake. Just tweaks the knee a little bit as she... We don't get to see the replay of her there, but just... caught in an awkward position, and Oletina just walking around there, just trying to walk the effects off, and the umpire as ever, encourages them to play. Well, Shirose definitely working harder here towards the back of the court. There's no doubt that she's working all around, but again, that forehand shot, having responded to some good deep shots on the backhand, it was the forehand deep shot that Shirose just almost, she was relieved that she was getting an easier shot on the forehand, and she sort of almost relaxed as she played the shot and ended up just hitting it mid-court, and Olitina smashed those away every day of the week. Olitina, oh, that's a beautiful shot. That really is a good shot from Shirose. I think that's the best shot she's played this match. And that's the sort of thing where Shirose at the back of the court now, trouble is that Olitina senses that Shirose doesn't have the power to go corner to corner. Oh, what a shot from Shirose. She's pulled this one level. And that's, again, that's two great shots from a Hungarian racket in 2 points. Olitina just looks a little bit rattled there. As Olitina's playing her tactics. She's playing lots of shots to the back of the court. And Shirose giving her all sorts of trouble. That one just long. Well, at least she's fighting now in this game. This is more of a badminton contest, and that's what we want to see here. Shirose definitely up in her game, and this is, that's another good shot. Olitina will always be going long, and that looks in. No, called out. And no challenge. So, we'll never know.
Service over. 5-6.
Well, Shirose at least giving this one more of a challenge here on court number one here at the Baku Sports Hall. Good rally, this is good. Oh, Shirose may have left that, but she's left a few down that side that she's ended up.
8-5.
It's ended up being on, so being in the court, so she obviously has that in the back of her mind a little bit. Olitina just edging into a 3-point lead here. And Shirose's big shot doesn't come off.
9-5. Service over. 6-9.
Well, certainly the coach for Hungary will be a lot happier at this break than he was in the first break. He really didn't feel his player was challenging at all. She's now stepping it up. She's looking good at the back of the court, she's playing some beautiful drops. And Olitina's having to work a lot harder than she did in game number one. Shirose into the net though from the back of the court. And the warning bells are just starting to sound a little bit in the Hungarian side. 4-point gap. This is a good rally. And Olitina into the net again. A lovely backhand cross court from Shirose.
Service over, 11-7.
And Bolutina looking very, very good indeed here. 11-7 lead in game number two. It's probably just as well we don't have our camera there listening into what they're saying. Oh. Interesting to hear, you know, but the couple of words that you could detect, bat's much better. And I think he's absolutely spot on there. She has worked her socks off in this second game. Olitina hasn't really changed anything at all from her tactics in game one. And of course the serve to the back. But Cerossi, oh, that's a beautiful shot from Olitina. Cerossi does amazingly to stay in the rally. What a point for the Hungarian to win there. That was superb. From Cerossi in black, really was hanging on in that point. Some great defense. And then Olitina in the end put it into the net. Oh, off the top of her net and in. A little bit of luck for the Ukrainian. Every point matters here. Could have been 11-9 and only 2 points gap, but instead it's a 4 point gap. Now a 5 point gap. And Cerossi needs to do something quickly here. At the moment, her game is all about really trying to defend from Olitina's attacks. She's not really got her own attack going there. You see a perfect example. Olitina all the time is the dominant force in these rallies. And Cerossi is very much just reacting. Again, Olitina goes to the back far side. That's where Cerossi's weakness is. Oh, good rally. That's good play. I think that was out. Yeah, maybe the previous one was out as well. Cerossi's going to challenge this one. Well, place your bets. What does the TV camera say? Ooh. I wouldn't mind seeing that again on a super slow-mo. But it's what the computer says that matters. As John McEnroe once said with this same system that's used on tennis. He said it may be no better than the human system, but at least it's a computer system and it's not emotional and you don't get home decisions. You just get the computer maybe making a mistake. It doesn't favor one way or the other. Now that's close, but just out. Worth a challenge, you would say. And Laura Cerossi has just one challenge left now. And she's probably not got a lot left here because she's 15-8 down now. And Maria Olitina, a little bit disappointed with that shot. Olitina, 5'10" or 178 centimeters. Cerossi, 5'6" or 167 centimetres, so good difference in height, 4 inches. Cerossi again defending well, but under pressure all the time. Weak shot from Olitina though. Cerossi didn't just have the power. That's so annoying for her. She worked herself back into a situation. And then she had a mid-court backhand that, well, just did nothing. And in the end, she just ended up feeding Maria Olitina, who'll smash that one away. But It was actually Shirose who was in the driving seat in that rally towards the end. Well, the umpire's trying to heavy them up again. Obviously, he's got a meal booked for tonight. Olitina moving around so smoothly, isn't she? I'm really liking her style. I think out of some of the matches that I've watched, I think she would probably have won the group there. I think the athlete who's actually won this group, Linda Zitschiri from Bulgaria. Well, she must be a player to have beaten Olitina. It was 21-18, 21-18, so quite close. Olitina goes body line down the middle. And this match has got pretty much game over, written all over it, hasn't it? Olitina just doing what she does best. Again, another long serve. She's putting Sarosi right at the back. Plays a loose shot. Cross-court drop. But she has such a good lead. 6 points. Oh, it's very dapper this evening. There you see again another example. Sarosi just doesn't have the power, does she? Olitina puts her onto the backhand. It wasn't a long-distant backhand either. It wasn't in the corner. It was just mid-court, and Sarosi couldn't do anything with it. And within three more strokes, it was point to Olitina. And, well, I think there's going to be a lot of work to do for the Hungarian. I pretty much imagine that her coach is going to be feeding her a lot of long shuttles for corner-to-corner shots, because she needs to do a lot of training in that area. Oh, Sarosi serve short.
20, match point, 14.
And I think she just wants to put her head in her hands and get out of here as quickly as possible. Olitina, there's 20 minutes on the clock. It's been pretty much, well, this match just, that rally just sums up the whole match. Solid victory for the Ukrainian, Maria Olitina. She will go through to the knockout section tomorrow. And, well, I've got to say, Lara Sarosi has got a fair bit of work to do on the training court. She really wasn't at the races at all here, and her tournament is complete in the women's singles. This rally just about summed it all up. Long, long serve. I think Olitina, can't remember the last time she put a short serve in. And there you see, within a couple of points, she's already on top of the net and finishes it off. A victory for the Ukrainians. She'll be playing in the knockout section tomorrow. There's the score, 21-9, 21-14. A very comfortable result.
The Baku Sports Hall. The action continues in the women's singles. Pick up a Group C match.
Ladies and gentlemen, am I right? Petya Denicheva, Bulgaria. My left, Fabienne de Press of Germany.
And from Sweden now, umpires Hakan Fosto. Third seed is Petya Nedelcheva. The red shirt closest to us. And we'll start as a slight favorite in this one. She's ranked 39 in the world. Her opponent, Depre, is 93. So right hander against left. Velcheva, a far more experienced player at 31. 25 titles in singles and doubles throughout Europe. So the Bulgarian has been around the game a while. split the first 2 points. The long reach of the Pratt, just not quite good enough to get there. Lovely deception from Nedelcheva. Oh, great smash down the line. Nedelcheva couldn't react in time. A little drop shot over the net again from the Bulgarian. That's something Dupre is going to have to adjust to quite quickly. Otherwise, it'll be a winning tactic deep into this first game. So it's all about reading your opponent, getting to know their game quickly.
4-2.
Little bit of help off the top of the net.
Three, four.
Dupre will take it. She was the 2013 German singles champion and runner-up in 14 and 15.
Serves over 5-3.
Good. The first dozen points can often be a bit of a sorting out process, not very many long rallies as they adjust to each other's serving style. Certainly Nedelcheva getting the better of the early exchanges. From Nedelcheva, not sure she could have got to it anyway, but she now takes a 4-point lead early. Straightens out the feathers. Smash was good, might have damaged the shuttle actually as we go for a new one. Dupre has studied business administration. Both her parents played, which she says is what drew her to the sport at quite a young age. Born in Langenfeld.
Serves over 4-8.
Successful tactic to Dupre, driving it straight at the Bulgarian on the smash. Let's that one go, but a wrong decision this time from Dupre.
9-5.
Had a look and stayed on her own side, unfortunately, for Fabienne Dupre. Straight to the feet. Dupre, no digging that one up for the German. Nedelcheva made the third round of both the Athens and Beijing Olympic Games. I mentioned she's been around a while. She was the voted the best Balkan player of the decade for 2000 to 2010. Reasonable to say, I think, that Fabian Dupree looks the fitter of the two, but Nedeljkova, I think, knows the shortcuts around the court. She's got the experience and the results.
Service over. Six,
he makes no 11. Effort to get to that one. The smash too good. Could do no more than get out of the way, Dupree. A vicious smash six. From Nedeljkova. Well, this might be the answer for Dupree if she's to climb back into this 12. First game and the second to move Nedeljkova around. She looks reluctant to take more than a step and a half to the shuttle. It'll create the angles to do that, though, and not be on the defensive. And in fact, it was Nedeljkova pushing Dupree all around the court to take it to 13-7. Really controlled the rally from midcourt, didn't have to take much lateral movement to dominate. Nedeljkova by half a dozen over Dupree. Ooh.
14-7.
Just. That was a very finely judged by Nedeljkova. That high angle down onto the court, a little deceptive. A little shorter than Nedeljkova, but she's got long arms, good reach. She goes up early for the smash when she wants it. Yep. And just moved into the net. She knew where that was coming, Nedeljkova, with Dupree caught at the back. Nedeljkova just drop shot for 15-8, and this ought to be a straightforward process to get to the end of the first game. Nedeljkova leads the group. This is Group C with two victories, no losses.
16-8.
Right idea, but you need the execution. It wasn't quite there. Oh, exquisite. That's one of the shots of the game so far from Dupree.
17.
Nedeljkova is having a bit of trouble reading the shuttle off the racket, particularly from the smash of Dupre, and that one sharply cross-court. Down the line, and Nedeljkovic was leaning the other way. Yes, just wide. Again, trying to work the angles. I think judging the whether the shuttle is in or out is a really 18. Interesting difference between this court sport and tennis, where obviously players can wait for the ball to bounce and they know, have a very good idea whether it's in or out. Here, the call has to be made earlier, and it's a whole skill in itself as Dupre
12-18.
Takes a score to a dozen. Sometimes you see players who are in and out of form just with their judgment on whether the shuttle's in or out. Make some bad leaves, all good ones, often in succession. Nedeljkovic by 7 in this opening game of the Group C fixture.
Game point 12.
He's got a little bit to say. Petr Nedeljkovic should be quite happy with the game and match situation. First to 21. She's almost there. Oh, too good. Very subtle change of direction. And she takes the first game. Nedeljkovic. 21-12. Well, Nedeljkovic jumped out to an 8-3 lead, went to the interval 6 up at 11-5, and won it by 9. So, in horse racing parlance, she won it easing away. Let's see what the second game brings. Still suggests that if Dupre can find a way to move her opponent around, she might get herself some points on opponent out of position and reluctant to chase.
Някак си много такова губи странен. Въртяш ми идва сервиза, просто идва въртиливо едно.
Защото трябва да е настрани. И след...
Just about set for resumption of play between Petr Nedeljkovic of Bulgaria and Germany's Fabien Dupre. Dupre 23, Nedeljkovic 31. Nedeljkovic born in Stara Zagora.
Court 1, 20 seconds.
Actually 32 next month is Nedeljkovic, and the reason she loves badminton, she says she enjoys the battle, the preparation, the contest, the struggle.
Game,
so she serves it, taking the first 21-12. Oop, slip there.
One, love.
Not sure why she's lost her footing here. Just lunging for the shuttle, really. The Praise had some chronic knee problems, long-term knee soreness, and she spent a fair bit of time out of the game late 13, early 14. But she's made what she says is a full recovery and plays without pain.
Serves over, one all.
You can find pictures of her quite readily with playing with Kinesi tape on her knees. She's come up with the right management strategy.
Serves over, 2-1.
Challenge immediately from Nedelcheva. To pray, let that one go. I would like to call it from here. Looked pretty close. Nedelcheva wasted no time. I think it's a really interesting addition to badminton at this top level to have a couple of challenges each for the match. Nedelcheva an opportunity to at least towel down while she waits for the decision. Oh, well. You say that's a good lead by Dupre, but not a bad challenge by Nedelcheva. Nothing in it. Out. So we go across to Dupre to serve at 1-2. Two all, I beg your pardon, because of course the point goes to her.
Serves over, 3-2.
Dupre fooled by that one. Slow to move to it. Down the line from Nedelcheva. This is better work. Opening of the second game by Dupre. It's not enough to react in this game. To some extent, you've got to predict where the shuttle's going off your opponent's racket rather than waiting. It's all over too quickly if you do that. And that's where the deception comes in from the attacking player or the hitting player. Oh, that's wide, but not long. 4-3. That one's long. From Dupre, she's looking sharp, certainly moving as well as she did early in the first game. No question about her fitness, she's got very light on her feet. And she's hit the lead. Well, this is great surge from Fabienne Dupre, outplayed comprehensively in the first game where Nedelcheva just kept building and building the lead. Now, though, Dupre's worked out to some degree her opponent's game. Must keep it going, though. And 6-4, Germany. Well, Nedelcheva's been in this kind of situation plenty of times before. We'll draw on that experience. Nedelcheva asking for a new shuttle. with which Dupre will serve. She had no time to react. Her back was to Nedeljkova, just threw her racket at it and got the result for 8-4. What a remarkable point for Dupre. Yeah, that's worth a clap. She may not play a better shot than that in this match or in several more. Extraordinary reflexes. Well, Nedeljkova has absolutely stopped. Dupre has taken control of the second game. Considering Nedeljkova took the first by 9, it's amazing. That's better.
Serves over. 5-9.
Soft hands from Nedeljkova to affect the drop shot. Just a little dab. A little dab will do you.
Serves over. 10.
Fractionally long from the Bulgarian. Back out to 5 for Dupre. Oh, that's an uncharacteristic smash error from Dupre. She's ranked some 54 places lower than Nedeljkova, who's at 39, Dupre 93. It's confusing the way you phrase it. One is a lower number, but it's a higher ranking, if you get my drift. Dupre, the less experienced at 93 in the world and giving away 8 years to Nedeljkova. Dropped in.
8-10.
That's not such a good lead from Dupre. She was leading 9-4. So a 4-1 run from Bulgaria's Petra Nedeljkova. So the charge from the German is stalled. Nedeljkova just slowing things down. Good.
Service over, 11-8, interval.
And there's the interval. So Nedeljkova just a little reluctant to chase that one. It's the kind of placement that may serve Dupre well. Just turn Bulgarian around, play it to the corners. She's less likely to pursue it. As the game wears on, might find that a productive tactic.
Натам по-високо, за да не излизат във фаул. Не е вярно, не е вярно. От тук натам вятъра се обърна. така че пълна концентрация.
11-8 emerges from the interval, play. Leading by three. Oh.
Serve's over.
Players and coaches 11. Feel the first point after the interval is crucial to win. Front, you're continuing to dominate. If you're trailing, you may be starting something. Nedelcheva gets it back to two. Oh dear, that's a wild
10,
shot.
And 11.
Dupre looks at the lights, looking to blame something for catching that one pretty much on the frame. Good. Tied Nedelcheva up in knots.
12-10.
Forces are back. Lost her bearings a little. It's a tight call in any event. Even if she'd been there, she'd be entitled to leave it and get it wrong, as it turned out.
Some
power in the smash 11, from Nedelcheva. She's to take this in two games, the Bulgarian. She needs to hit the lead soon. From Dupre. She'd really covered some court in that rally. It was dominated by Nedelcheva. She had a set up camp in the middle and pushed the German around.
Once again, you don't walk here, you stay on court. Okay?
Umpire Eugen Foster just having a word or two to Nedelcheva about where she can walk in between points. No sign of a yellow card caution. Nedelcheva hits the lead. Yes, if you're not familiar with it, there is a card system in badminton to warn players for unsporting behaviour. Just throwing the racket under the net or delaying the game, that kind of thing. A couple of yellows constitute a red, and two reds constitute a black card, which means you can be disqualified from the game. We are, of course, a very, very long way from that happening because we haven't had the first yellow card, but just words between umpire and Nedelcheva. Oh, lovely disguise on the forehand from Dupre. Just back in front. This is a tight go in the second. Well, the shuttle just dropped on her a little. The timing off from Dupre with the round the head smash. No. an unusual leave from Dupre, shall we say. That was well in. Mr. Felcher just could not get into a position to hit. Surely she sensed that was going to land in the court. Well, these are troubling signs for the German, who led by as many as five early in this second game. 9-4 she was up and went to the interval 11-8. She's been outscored 8-3 since the interval. It out with the head was Nedeljkova. It's always long. She's just four from the match now. Good old chat to herself. She wants to appeal that one, Dupre. Well, she may as well. The situation's pretty grim, but 18-15 might be as good as gone. 16-17. Maybe this is more in hope than expectation. Maybe she got a little signal from coaching staff there that it was worth an appeal. Maybe she just needs a bit of a break here to try and shift the momentum away from Nedeljkova. It was long.
Challenge unsuccessful. Lift the press. One challenge remaining. Service over. 18-15.
Stays with Nedeljkova. Straight at the body.
19-15.
Nedeljkova's turned around a 3-point deficit at the interval to lead by four. And she's 2 points from making it a 3-0 progression through the group stage. This being a game from Group C. She's the third seed and certainly top seed in this group. Ray goes for a new shuttle. Looking for a change of luck here. Can't really afford to drop any of the next 3 points, otherwise it's match point. great angle and pops it on the line for the winner.
17-19.
It doesn't look like she's feeling the pressure of the match situation. Wow, very subtle.
18-19.
Belcheva just tightening up a little, perhaps. That was just over. Too good for Nedeljkovic. Towards the error and gets to 19 all. This is a very nifty comeback from the Prey. Starting to take a physical toll on both players. Plenty of perspiration, plenty of blowing on the racket hand. Keep a good grip. Again, the angle gets Nedeljkovic in trouble.
19.
And now it's game point to Fabienne Desprez. Trouble leaving that Nedeljkovic. A little slow to get up off the court. At least the court wiped. I hope she's all right.
Phone call, please.
Umpire Akinfosto asking for the players to get on with it.
20-0.
Does it go to a third, or does Nedeljkovic wrap it up in two? Bulgarian's got her opportunity now.
21, match point, 20.
Went back the same way, down that same line, and Nedeljkovic was leaning the other way. So one match point saved. Certainly taking their time between points. The seriousness of the situation might be adding to that. Touch of fatigue too. Nedeljkovic probably hit an out shuttle early in the rally down that left line as we look at it, but didn't matter in the end as Prey put one in the net to present another match point to Petra Nedeljkovic. She'd take it the second invitation. Not yet. Another one saved.
22-all.
Well, this is a great finish to this second game, whatever happens. Whether we go to a third or whether Nedeljkovic moves through, we've had some good entertainment here late in the second game. Plenty of pluck from Desprez. She's worked Nedeljkovic out to some degree. but that's a tired mistake, perhaps.
23-22.
Some positive looks coming from her bench, but Nedelcheva, third match point. And third time lucky, there it is. Took some doing. Three match points she needed. Nedelcheva comfortably took the first game, 21-12. But all credit to Fabienne Dupre, who came back in the second game, led for much of it. Let's give some credit to the experience and court craft of Petya Nedelcheva, who moves through the group having won all three of her matches. Second game, a real struggle. The long shuttle on match point, the third from Fabienne Dupre, presents it to Nedelcheva. Good game, she says. Well played. But the victory to Nedelcheva, 21-12, 24-22 in Group C. Next match we have for you at the Baku Sports Hall is a Group B men's doubles match between Turkey and France. Emre Vural and Sinan Zorlu. Right,
Emre Vural, Sinan Zorlu, Turkey. And on my left, Bastian Kersudi, Gaetan Mittelheiser, France.
And our umpire, Ivanka Pokorni of Croatia, completes the introduction for me. So thanks to Ivanka. The French combination ranked 62 in the world and the Turkish boys 84. Suggest the French team slightly the stronger, and they take the first couple of points. Bastien Kersudi, the taller of the French lads, at 192 or 6 feet four. Mittelheiser, shorter at 181, 5'11. Well, it doesn't look to be that height difference between them. Both the Turkish players just either side of 6 feet, 186 for Zorlu and Vural at 181, or 5'11 and 6'1. Mention that just because of the reach and the height. Really important factor in the sport of badminton. If you're not tall, you better be quick. And Turkey on the board. Serve. One straight at the body. Good option from Kersudi. Start from the French pair. Rare error at the net. Pretty soft one from Kersudi. Bastian Kersudi, nicknamed Bastu. to a second place, runner-up finish in the European Junior Championships in Tokyo. The big Frenchman picked up the game at the age of six with his dad. And he regards these European games as the biggest tournament he's attended. Sitting at six for France. Mittelheiser serving again.
Play, please.
Oh. Top smash from Sinan Zorlu. Four of these men in their early 20s. French team both 21, Vural 23, Zorlu 20. Vural has improved his world ranking in singles in the last 12 months, 200 places. 350 to 150. Wow, that's a great exchange. And really, a lot of these rallies, there's no time to communicate. It's a judgment call who takes the shuttle. And the French get the better of this one. Zorlu, clearly frustrated, losing that one. They go to the interval with a six-point deficit. The urgency and the voice of the coach, understandable. 11-5 France.
11-5.
Very sharp, aggressive, willing to smash at every opportunity. Very quick hands, close in on the net. Trying to dominate there. First game getting quickly away from Turkey. Sorty serves. Oh, Zorlu, what was he doing? He put in a couple of great smashes, but limply into the net. Down the middle. No decision from Vural and Zorlu to go for that.
15-6.
Court sport doubles. Just look for that corridor of doubt. Liza serves.
16-6.
Thank you. easily the rally of the match. And the point goes to Turkey. There's just a more attacking mood about this French team. They smash when they can. They dominate at the net when they can. The counter-punching of Turkey, though, wins the day, at least the rally. But 7-16 down. Plenty of trouble in this opening game.
Service hold call. Service over. 17-7.
Service fault. Shuttle a bit high. Shuttle needs to be below the waist. The racket coming up, not down. It's usually the error call, or can be a footwork problem as well. One put into the net by Mittelhauser. But playing this game positionally quite differently, that the French are looking to get to the net as quickly as they can and as often as they can, at least one player, whereas the Turkish pair, Sinan Zorlu and Emre Vural, are just holding back. The ownership of the court is very much with the French. Well, good response.
Service over. 10-18.
Nice work with the French in the I formation. The corner was open. Just had to step up and put it there. But Mittelhauser again and again prepared to back his reflexes at the net. I like his attitude. You've got to get it past me. Not quite ready. Ivanka Pokorny says, no, let's settle down, have another go.
18.
Of a run here from Turkey. They were down 17-7, so they're 4-1 run here, but one into the net, unfortunately, from Emre Vural. Certainly there to make a play on it. Turkey have certainly had the better of the last 7 or 8 points, but they've just given up too big a lead, I think, to rescue this first game. The better players come too late. Looks to be some mild concern from Kasordi and Mittelhauser. They haven't closed it out more quickly than this. Still back them to do so. Straight at his opponent, Mittelhauser. Gave them no room to swing. And game point has arrived for the French. Service direction delivered to his teammate behind a hand. Turkey in the rally, though. And that's that. Lob it up in the general direction of Kasordi when he's got time to swing. And the big man puts it away. They established a big lead early and never relinquished it, France. 11-5 at the interval, 17-7 late in the first game. And they've won it by 8. So much for Turkey to consider in a short space of time as they look to turn this one around. Turkish team were beaten by Ivanov and Sozhenov, but they had a win over the Azerbaijan pair, Kalandarov and Ryazhev. And the French pair have also got 1-1. So this is a really important game. Winner set to go through. Just like that, one, two, three. Three quick hits and the point's done. Can go like that in men's doubles and women's. France first on the board. That's the benefit of the aggression from Mittelheiser. He's so close to the net that if he can get racket on shuttle, it gives the Turkish boys so little time to react. Time though, the smash straight at the feet of Kasordi. Long way down from where he is at 192 centimetres. Mistake on serve from Turkey. They hurt when you're chasing. A serve deeper this time. Emily Vural finally gets the better of it. Major achievement in the sport is a third placing he received at the Islamic Solidarity Games in Indonesia 2 years ago. Guess why? Turkey. This looks better. And then they swoop for a 6-4 lead in the second game. They're starting to piece it together. Being allowed to play more aggressively. Oh, and they've just watched it. Confusion between Vural and Zulu. Whose shuttle was that? Two-point lead is quickly evaporated. Bastian Kasordi serves. Mittelheiser got up. And the trick is to get it to the floor as quickly as possible.
Seven, six.
one's going. Oh, was there any shot they didn't play? And that's the second big rally that Turkey have taken from the French. And our umpire, Ivanka Pokorny, she enjoyed it too. That is super badminton. Although, you may not tell her, looking at the Turkish. He should be happy. 7-7. It's a bit soft. It's quick for a big man, Bastian Kasodi. Wittelhäuser. Yes. All they could do was lob up and wait to get hit again, and Vural. That a little bit closer, able to affect the kill. I like Mittelhäuser. He loves the opportunity to leap and smash, and he was close enough to make it a winner. France 9-8, being given much better game of it in the second game by Turkey. Alright, some equipment change for the French. So a couple of quick hits to make sure he's got a feel for it.
9-8.
Where was this play from Turkey in the first game?
They
really decided they need to step up and attack. Got to be in position to do it, of course. Keep it away from Wittelhäuser at the net. He's so dominant there, so quick. Great hands. And France back in front, 10-9. Turkey led by a couple early in this second game, having dropped the first, 21-13. And there's the interval, the French in front again. I hope Turkey aren't discouraged. They played very good badminton in this second game. Diving Sinan Zorlu. Couldn't get there. Maybe a little consolation, but Turkey have won the two best points of the match, perhaps, here in the second game. They trail it by two.
11-9. Play. Service over. Пен. Тепер.
Ooh, good leave.
Service over. 13-10. Service over.
Bastian Cassotti.
11.
Has had a win in the Brazilian Open. Along with that runner-up finish in the European Junior Championships. It's a partner here, Gaetan Mittelheiser. 3 years ago, had a third place finish in the Mediterranean Games. Different partner.
Service over 12-14.
I'm interested to see that Mittelheiser has attended tertiary education studying kinesiology. It's in good company here in this badminton field. There's a few of the boys have studied that. It's helped them manage their injuries. A bit about health management and treatment. But right now, it's the Turkish game that needs a band-aid at five down in the second. France closing in on the match. Verse 21-13. Turkey briefly in front in the second game. It's all going a little awry for Turkey's Emre Vural and Sinan Zorlu. Kasori to serve again.
Out. Service over. 13-18.
I think this court-level camera gives you a great perspective on how quick the reflexes have to be. You're almost feeling it as the players do. The speed of the shuttle, the quickness of the hands.
15-18.
Quick wipe down for Mittelheiser. Just long, and 2 points from the match of France.
19-15.
Mittelheiser looks a picture of composure. He loves this battle close to the net. Down the middle goes Vural, and again they win the long rallies. 19-16.
16-19.
And it was past them. Too quick. Must win points here for Turkey. 16-19 and down a game. Match point.
20. Match point. 60.
Oh, and the serve does it. Well, France only briefly trailed Through most of the match, they were the more aggressive team, and that's particularly true of Gaetan Mittelheiser, who looked to dominate at the net. And they make a good pair, the height, the reach of Kasordi and his power, Mittelheiser's wonderful reflexes. It was just a bit too much for Emre Vural and Sinan Zorlu. Took the first game rather comfortably. Turkey did make an impressive run at them in the second. France, they can smile as they move on the back of a 21-13, 21-16 victory over Turkey. Group F singles match for the women between Ireland's Chloe McGee and Leanne Tan of Belgium.
Ladies and gentlemen, on my right, Leanne Tan, Belgium. And on my left, Chloe McGee, Ireland. Chloe McGee to serve. Level play.
We're under the control of umpire David Graf von Schwerin. McGee, top of the picture. Well, the evidence of that first rally, better settle in, folks. This could be a long one.
Service over.
Chloe McGee, ranked number 48 in the world, has been as high as 32. That was in May last year, and she is the sixth seed.
Chloe McGee challenge called out.
Pretty brave making a challenge in just the second point of the match. You've only got a couple to play with. Chloe must be confident. Oh, if that's caught the line, it's the outside of the line. Let's see if she's right. She's from Letterkenny in County Donegal. Rafoe is the university. Went to Royal and Prior Rafoe College, at least. And, oh, she's made a good call by that much. Wow, she's got good eyes. She's 26, Leanne Tan 24. Irish player with just a slightly greater reach, perhaps, at 164 centimetres, 160 is Leanne Tan. She was born in Bilsen in Belgium. Finally, enough on the smash from Tan to find out McGee.
4-1.
And she's out to a 4-1 lead, looking promising. Yes. Father and a sister played Leanne. And one of her best results has just come recently. The Belgian player won the Dutch International in April. Thank you. Not her best lead. It was pretty tight to the line. She let it go. Ooh. Has a look at the line, Judge. Chloe McGee will serve at 2-4. Both her brothers are here at the European Games as well, so it's really in the family, the McGees. She plays mixed doubles with her brother Sam. It's wide though. It's a more comfortable leave for Tan.
5-2.
Tan politely acknowledges the change of the shuttle.
Serves over 3-5.
Certainly has that in the armory, the angled shot, Chloe McGee. You're stuck without it. Such an important part of this game at the top level. And the disguise on it, the angled drop shot.
Serves over 6-3. And
McGee's done a great job to move Tan around until finally she forced the error out of the Belgian. McGee asking for a change of shuttle. Tan gestures across. Yes, please go ahead. Fist pump from Tan, almost congratulating herself on a judgment.
Serves over.
Tan not happy. Soft error on serve. Players must always feel like I've at least got to put it in play, make my opponent do something. She's gone the wrong way there, McGee.
Serve is over. 8-5.
Deceived by the setup, I think, by Liang Tan. And she's back out to a 3-point lead. 5-2, 6-3, 8-5. McGee, at this moment, just can't make an impression on the early lead established by the Belgian opponent. Oh, it's good. Drops on the line.
9-5.
See how both players are really trying to get back quickly to the center of the court. Both got a strong sense of position, these two.
11-5.
The angle was the answer, but you've got to clear the net first. And we go to the interval with Tan in a surprisingly impressive position. well, wasn't even close to clearing, and she's cross with herself, Chloe McGee. She's 33 places higher up the rankings, Chloe McGee. She should be doing well in this match, but...
Early tenet, just get up and stop it.
You're clear from the forehand, it's too flat.
It's too flat.
And she's cutting it out, and it's only double flying. You need to get that clear over her. And then
control the 2 points.
Come on, 2 points each time. Now. Give yourself small targets each time. Now.
Dig deep.
Come on, from here.
2 points each time, target.
In small packages, that's always sound advice. If, don't worry that you'd quite a few down, just chip away.
11-5. Play.
But for her part, Liang Tan will be thinking, well, let's get on with it. Right. Let her in the door. This is a really impressive opening game from Liang Tan.
13-5.
McGee, the leading player in this Group F. She's being sorted out here in the first game. Yes. That's good too.
14-5.
And Tan has won the first 3 points since the interval. Oh, that now the line judge hesitated there, was going to call it in, set out.
Called out.
And perhaps Tan saw the indecision from the official and thought, well, maybe I'll have a go here. But at 14-5, probably doesn't have too much to lose, but you never want to waste a challenge when you only have two. Must expect McGee to play better than this in the second game. This could be a long one. So Tan, hoping this was in. Decision soon enough. Not soon enough for the players who just want to get on with it. Sometimes it takes a while to crank up the technology. And in an ideal world, it doesn't take this long. Got to find an angle. Was out.
Challenge unsuccessful. Liang Tan, one challenge remaining. Service over. 6-14.
Took some doing. So Tan has wasted a challenge. And straight away, we've got another challenge.
Chloe McGee challenges called out.
She's just asked the other end of the court whether that was good or not. I don't know whether she's asking Tan. What do you think at home? Here it comes. Look out. This is the downside of the technology being involved, but mostly I'm in favour of it. If it any errors it takes out of the game, I'm in favour of.
Challenge unsuccessful.
It was well out.
Chloe McGee, one challenge remaining. Serve is over. 15-6. Play. Serve is over. 7-15.
Pace has just been taken out of the game by these two challenges. Both unsuccessful. It may bother these players late in the game if it does go on. Ooh, that's good. Picks up the line, does Leon Tan. You're up 16-7. It's not a game you should lose. Yes.
17-7.
Well, she's fired up, Leon Tan.
18-7. Serve over.
8-18. McGee just cannot get a hold on this game. She's way below her best. It's more like it. She's going to make winners 18. Out of those cross-court drop shots. They've got to clear the net.
So
might as well kiss this game goodbye and make a fresh start in the second. Smash practice, we'll call it.
10-19.
Game point.
Serve is over. 20. Game point. 10. Serve is over. 11-20.
She only needed two attempts at it to wrap up the first game. Leon Tan, a surprisingly comfortable margin over Chloe McGee, higher-ranked player, yet to find her good game. And she's got an opportunity in the second. Make the end of the first game some kind of punctuation point. I'm not sure we'll see better badminton from her. Tan, all credit to her.
Stop here.
Chloe McGee, a naturally aggressive player. See how she takes the fight up in the second game to Lian Tan. Both players out well before they need to start the second game.
Level play.
Tan of Belgium, dark strip.
Serve is over. One love.
A real swat at that. Gets Tan on the board in the second game.
Yes, change.
McGee won the 2011 Lithuanian Open singles and the 2011 Norwegian Open mixed doubles with brother Sam. Mentioned that they played together in mixed.
Serve is over. 2-1.
Subtle change coming over the game. A couple of errors from the Belgian. She's hit an out shuttle there, surely. Might have paid a price too. Well, this is a complete turnaround.
5-1.
Well, not quite sure what to make of this. A Tan who led all the way through the first game, took a 21-11. Finally picks up
two,
the line with a smash.
Six.
She just looks to be rushing a bit. She's McGee won't let her. She holds up the hand. Tan absolutely stranded on her haunches at the net.
Seven,
nowhere to go.
Two.
She could see the funny side of it. I don't think she could accuse McGee of trying to hit the shuttle at her. McGee had to go somewhere, and anywhere she went was over Tan's head. Good. Did not read that off the racket. Yang Tan.
8-2.
And she's down by 6. Make that 7.
9-2.
Lovely. Beautiful court movement. Teasing McGee this way and that. Yang Tan back to her best.
9.
Albeit briefly. Momentum's a funny thing in sport. Once you lose it, it's so hard to get it back. It was all with Tan in the first.
4. 9.
A couple of points back to back here, maybe. It is swinging back to her. Come on, says McGee. That's good. A little fist pump from McGee.
10-4.
Wants to go to the interval right now and make a statement. Let the Belgian look at the scoreboard. Wow.
Service over.
She's made a few mistakes on that little cross-court drop shot. It's beautiful when it comes off. That's good.
Service over. 11.
Tan thinks about it, but she's already burnt one challenge and isn't going to use up another one there. So 11-5. That was exactly the score at the interval in the first game, except it was Tan who was leading. It's all turned around.
Et essayer de trouver la hauteur. Même chose au niveau des lifts. Probablement, à chaque fois que tu fais des lifts, c'est des lifts à plat trop court. Tu passes chaque fois au-dessus d'elle. Et qu'elle bouge énormément. Okay, c'est là-dessus que tu dois te focaliser, uniquement là-dessus. La faire bouger dans le fond avant de la mettre au filet et essayer de garder la hauteur dans tes lifts.
Core 1, okay, 20 seconds. Core 1, 20 seconds.
Coach, and I assume Tan, French-speaking 11, Belgian.
5. Play.
Oh, that's a bit sloppy.
6, 11.
Tan picks up the first 2 points after the interval. Crucial for her to do that with such a margin. And if she's to try and wrap it up in two.
Four.
Yeah, well, McGee just set up camp at the net. She was dominant in the latter half of that rally. Was always likely to win it.
Yes, change.
Another change of shuttle. McGee is going to accept that one. Just has a look around.
12.
Doesn't challenge. That's good.
9-12.
And since the interval, Tan has halved the deficit. Long, or they were exploring the angles and the whole of the court in that lovely rally. That's 13, that's class badminton, both players. McGee has the serve though. Oh, can't do much about that. Right in the corner from the Belgian.
Team.
11-13.
Really interesting service action that Tan has. She's very close to having the racket head above the shaft. It's parallel, it's a near thing. I think the shuttle is low enough, but the position of the racket's pretty interesting.
14-12.
How often she gets called for it. Well, McGee's going to risk it. She's using a second challenge here. She wants it to be out. It was called in. Now the second game just getting a bit tight for her. She was leading 11-5. But since the interval, Tan has been edging back into it. Well, it's good. Well, that's both gone now.
Successful. Chloe McGee, no challenge remaining. Service over, 13-14.
Sometimes I think players just will it out and clouds their judgment. They just want it out so badly. Nine-3 since the interval in favor of Tan.
McGee
quickly gets one back. McGee has a sensational stretch lunge. She's able to cover, seems like 2 meters with just one long stride. She's incredibly flexible. Saw her in an earlier match out doing the splits on the floor twice. She was totally unbothered by it. She's a really agile, flexible player. Working hard to push this to a third game. Back out by two. Tan somehow managed to level at 14 all after being down by six at the interval. Into the net comes McGee and closes that one out.
18-15. Chloe, play.
Chloe McGee just been given a little bit of a hurry up from our umpire. David Graf von Schwerer.
16-18.
Tan is going nowhere. She's digging in, trying to wrap this up in two. It's really interesting watching them hit the shuttle and it's close to the line. You think, would that have gone out? And it's an answer you can never truthfully, knowingly give. If they hit it, that's that. No chance. 19, Irish coach happy 17. With the aggression here from McGee. She was retreating, just couldn't get back quickly enough, Tan. Just got closer and closer to the net. When the shuttle was presented above the net, McGee pounced.
Game point 18.
This to take it to a third. Not just yet.
19-20.
He just sometimes goes for a little too much with the soft hands, too delicate. Oh, there'd be some damage done in the mind of McGee if she lets this game slip. She's up 11-5 at the interval.
Serve's over.
Game point again.
20.
Usually the umpire will call game point when it is. We know it is. And it's good in the corner. And there is the second game to Ireland's Chloe McGee. So we'll go to a third. Leon Tan took the first 21-11. Well, there was a lot of momentum changes in that second game. Tan seemed to have lost her way early. Lead was out to 6. Through the first 10 points, came back strongly, forced it to extra points. We'll go to a third.
Court 1, 20 seconds. Court 1,
it's a game each. Tan has won more points overall than her opponent. 41-33. Matters little now as they go to the third.
Final game. Level. Play. Serve is over. One, all.
Almost. almost every point, you'll hear that little come on from the Irish player. Smashes wide.
Serve is over. 2-1.
Just look for little signs from either player that there might be some fatigue, some clouded decision making.
3-1.
Sometimes here it's said that the first thing to go when the body tires is decision making.
Serve is over. 2-3.
McGee win here would make both players 2-1 in this group F. That's good. That's it. That's decision making right there, whether to leave or to hit. It's probably a poor one by Tan. It's in by a few centimeters. Backside behind the back line. And McGee wasn't going to make a mess of that. It's a feisty customer, I think, McGee. She wouldn't mind me saying that. She's like a little hyperactive back there. Real fighter. It's a three-point lead here. Tan looks a little confused. Now she's going to claw her way back into this crucial third game. So Tan has had wins over Katie Tolmoff and Christine Sophia.
Serve is over. 4-7.
He has split those games. And Tan just showing some frustration, which we've really not seen too much of in the first two games. McGee by 4. And a fist pump. She knows that was crucial. She builds the lead to 5. She's starting to get the better of Tan. Is she tiring the Belgian? 21-11 she won the first. Used up a lot of energy in losing the second. And McGee looking the stronger now. Test for both players, that rally. Tan coming up with it, just catching the top of the net was McGee. That's good.
Serve is over. 10.
Still stronger on the angles, I think it's fair to say, about McGee. And She's close to going to the interval with another good lead. It was 11-5 in the second. Both players showing a bit more emotion now.
Chloe, get ready to play.
And for the second time, David Graf von Schwerin, the umpire, has had to still have a word to the Irish player about being ready.
The Antan challenges called in.
Well, Tan thought that was out. McGee has already walked over, expecting the interval. An 11-6 lead. It might be 10-7. Well, pretty close to the line to me, but I don't think that overhead angle is the best to try and make a call on it. Foreshorten it a little. Just leave it in the hands of the technology, and it's good.
Challenge unsuccessful. Liang Tan, no challenge remaining.
So both players have used up their challenges, and they go to the interval 11-6 in favour of McGee. Crucial moments coming up for Liang Tan. She's down 11-6, a game apiece. This could even depend on how many points the loser scores as to who goes through. It's a very tight group, Group F. Moment, it's beyond my arithmetic. Depends also on another game, but I'll be fighting for everything here, as you can tell from this rally. And it flops in. She was anchored to the spot in the middle of the court, McGee. There was no getting back there. And the long rally, the telling rally, is taken by Tan. She's still down by 5. A point each since the interval. Tan doesn't look the least physically distressed, but she might be mentally tiring. I'll take that back. She puts the hands to the ribs. Maybe she is feeling it.
Serves over 8-13.
The trick is to give your opponent nothing. Don't give any signals that you're physically distressed or cross. It's in. It's one of the ways the great Roger Federer over the years has frustrated opponents, whether he won a rally or lost it. the reaction was almost the same. It's indefatigable. He just couldn't read him. McGee at 16-8. Well, she's close now. Very pleased that went out. She'd spent a lot of energy in that rally, and there was no way she was going to get there. That's out, and she's barely hanging on. Tan looked so good in the first game. 21-11. McGee now just 4 points from the match. She's dug in well. Totally out of sorts in the first. Found the game. Looking good for it now. And they're pretty concerned over on the Belgian side of things. Leon Tan in all sorts of bother. Slap of the thigh from McGee. Wrong choice of shot, perhaps.
10-18.
That's good. Slow to react was Tan.
Service over 11-19.
Well, point for point is fine for Chloe McGee. She's got too big a lead to be worried about winning back-to-back points. Tan, though, back to the wall. And match points are plenty against her.
Service over 20, match point 11.
And there it is. Wraps it up on the second match points. Chloe McGee finishing much the stronger. She takes it in three from Leon Tan. She should do. She is the sixth seed and highest ranked player in this Group F. She was less than at her best in the first game. 11-5, she trailed at the break, and Tan went on with a 21-11. McGee fought back in the second. Late in the second, actually allowed Tan back into it. But 22-20 to force it to a third. And in that third game, there was really only one player in it. Chloe McGee prevails. It was a battle. Sometimes you win ugly. 11-21, 22-20, 21-12. A It's a Group H singles match next on my right, under Fabio Betto. Russian Federation.
And on my left, Alesia Zaitseva, Belarus. Natalia Perminova to serve. Lavol.
Perminova, closest to the camera. Perminova has been inside the top 40 in the world. That was October last year. She was number 38. She's now sitting at number 50. Zaitseva from Belarus. She had a best ranking of 72, but that was 3 years ago. She's now slipped out to 117. But there are some good signs from Zaitseva that she might be climbing the rankings again. She won the Lithuanian Open earlier this month. Beg your pardon, to reach the fourth round of the Lithuanian Open. It was the 2010 Slovakia International. That was her standout achievement. But Perminova with a 3-1 lead early. Clever little drop shot from Perminova. It's giving up 6 years of experience. She is the eighth seed, Perminova.
Service over, 2-4.
So there are eight groups. This is Group H, and they've spread the seeds across those groups.
Service over, 5-2. Fault.
And just off the top of the racket from Perminova.
3-5.
So across we go to Alesia Zaitseva. Zaitseva's father was a very active sportsman. He introduced her to the game of badminton. She was only six or so when she took it up at school. Well, a little bit sloppy at the net there from Perminova. Flipped the wrist at it, and she's allowed Belarusian to draw level at 5-5. Oh, that's in, isn't it? Looked it.
6-5.
It is indeed. So Zaitseva mentioned she won the Slovakia International in 2010, but she ranks above that her victory in the Bulgarian Open in 2012. Interesting racket work from Perminova. Sometimes she seems a very wristy player. Other times, not so much flexibility. As we say in this game, it's all about deception and disguise. Make your opponent move the wrong way. Or hit it straight at them.
Seven all.
The body shot's a good one. No room to swing. Oh, that might have picked up the line.
Service over.
It has.
Eight, seven.
Just a trace of frustration there in the body language of Natalia Perminova. Both these players coming in at 2-0 in their record.
Service over, 8-all.
Zaitseva beat the Lithuanian Stapiusatia 21-17, 21-9.
Alessia Zaitseva challenge.
The walkover.
Called out.
The retired Sonia Olariu. So at 8-all, first challenge. It's been called out. Time for the players to take a drink. And out
challenge
it is.
Alessia Zaitseva has one challenge remaining.
I'm sure the line officials feel a slight sense of vindication when the technology backs them up.
Service over, 9-all.
Looks like a bad lead from Perminova. She had a play on it, opted not to. That's good. A cross-court winner from Perminova. Back to tens. Body weight was just slightly in Zaitseva's left court. That was enough of an opening for Perminova. And Zaitseva puts it wide, so it will be the Russian leading by one as they go to the interval. Not much between these two.
Вот это вправо полусмешно с диагональю. И сама смотри, когда играешь, смотри, высокой далеки, раз, два, высокой далеки туда, в диагональ, она себе прокидывает туда. Попробуй подпрыгни, пробить по линии сразу. Ты дотягиваешься, да? Но скидываешь мяч, а ты чуть-чуть жестче
ударишь.
Сразу пробуй, потому что он там садит. Вот это вот, диагонали сразу линии, диагональ линии. А так хорошо, сама нет.
First 20 points of the match, surprisingly evenly shared considering the world rankings. Just a reminder, Zaitseva outside the top 100. I mean over 50 and has been as high as 38. I saw in that rally the very late wrist work of Perminova. It's a real strength of hers. Make it very tough to read off the racket for the opponent, especially on the backhand. And finally, what a rally. Well, Zaitseva was trying so hard to keep it away from Perminova's backhand, which we were just extolling the virtues of. And finally, Perminova got an opportunity at the net. Well, shuttle just dropped too much for Zaitseva to put something on it. She could only lob up. Perminova swooped. Both players exhausted by that one. Must have been 60 shots in that. Players will be hoping there aren't too many more of those. It's seemingly an extra value on the really long rallies. They're the ones you want to win. They don't want to make all that effort and get nothing for it. Then again, Zaitseva didn't have to do much to win the next point, as Perminova, perhaps through fatigue, makes a bad call. And a lazy shot.
13-all.
Belarusian coach looks a bit of a character. That's a better piece of judgment.
Service over,
Perminova.
14-30.
Oh. What's going on here? Perminova.
Service over, 14.
Surely had a play on that, and it was centimeters in. Distressed after that very long rally. Quite flushed in the face. Still taking its toll on her. That's good. Little fist pump from Perminova over that time.
Service over 15-14.
A subtly disguised drop shot, and she's back in front. great backhand of Romanova. Oh, and then she makes the mistake. She's got so much class, and yet still these little mistakes. Just a question there about whether Zaitseva could change the shuttle. Permanova wasn't watching. The question had been asked, and so our umpire Fabio Betto says, is it okay? She agrees. On we go.
Service over.
Lisa was out. 15. Just a quiet call from the official. I think Zaitseva has sensed that 17, extraordinarily 15. Long rally, half a dozen points ago, has really taken something out of Permanova. And if she can just move the Russian around. Oh, Zaitseva just ghosts across the net and puts the backhand over for a winner. Little flick of the wrist and it's all done. Zaitseva born in Brest, Belarus. Going to take this first game. 17 all. Permanova at times has looked like the more likely. Zaitseva digging in.
Fault.
I think Zaitseva's probably hurting just as much as Permanova with the pace of this match, but 17. Just doesn't look like she is. Could do no more than give up on that one. Zaitseva pulled it to the net and then put it over Permanova's head. And the pressure points are about to be played in this first game. They've given so much in it. Whoever loses this opening game will really struggle to be up for a three-game contest. Umpire cutting the players some slack here. They've really spent some petrol. Change of racket, couple of quick hits, make sure it's all right. And we resume at 18 all in the first between Natalia Permanova, closest to us in the blue top, and Alicia Zaitseva. Just out. Permanova gets the serve back.
19-18.
That's an error we've not often seen from Pimenova. Good hit at it, just low. Game point for the Russian.
It's over 20, game point 19.
Game. Yes, that was above the net, and Pimenova was quick enough to get to it and finish off the first game, 21-19. So Pimenova leads Zaitseva. It's a high quality and at times exhausting first game. Saw some beautiful play from both Pimenova and Zaitseva. Pimenova puts the first game in the bank, 21-19. Too high above the net. There's the winner.
Second game, level play.
Pimenova gets us underway in the second.
Service
over. Same mistake, either side of the net. Start us off in the second. A couple of tired looking shots, really. I think of the women's singles, we've not seen a tougher opening game in terms of the energy spent by both players. Just might see one or two rallies where a player doesn't chase as hard as they might have in the first. You sometimes see a player willing the shuttle out and it drops in. They're just too fatigued to chase. Haven't reached that point yet, but and perhaps we won't. Well, she was certainly wasn't going to chase that one, Permanova, but it was just Zaitseva pulling her to Permanova's left court. Left the other corner open. Zaitseva in front. Permanova made the third round of the Spanish International just a month ago. The eighth seed here, she'd certainly be expecting to progress. But the 6 years added experience Zaitseva has got and brought to bear.
Service over 4-0.
Neither player in the match so far has been able to establish a sizable points lead. The interval in the first was at 11-10.
Service over, 5-4.
The game won 21-19 by Permanova. Even though Permanova was forced to clear a couple of times in that rally, she just seemed to be doing it more easily. Now she's out by a couple. It's an impressive rally from her. That's good.
Service over, 5-6.
Backpedaling and losing your bearings ever so slightly. Well, enough to make an incorrect call on whether it was going to be in or out. Point to Zaitseva. Again, the players needing to towel down, keep the moisture off the court. Control of the match from Fabio Betto. He seems a very good umpire to me. He's got the respect of the players.
Service over.
That, I would say, is about the laziest shot we've seen from Alicia Zaitseva in the match. Fell at the bottom of the net. Leaves her at 5-7. Then again,
service
over, comes back with that.
6-7.
Out. Zaitseva had a racket nearby and just took it away.
Service
Zaitseva's coach applauding as his player hits the lead in the second game. First 21-19 to Pemenova. Disguise on the cross-court smash from Pemenova. Barely a word coming out of either player. Totally in control of their temperaments, it seems.
Service over 9-8.
They're just not the sort of players who are going to give an umpire a difficult match, are they? They seem very well behaved. Not too fiery, but giving it their all. Holds up the shuttle. Sometimes you just wonder what's wrong with it. It doesn't look too bad from here. They see things that we can't, and the umpire and the opponent must never decline the request. And Zaitseva just with a nice little run before the interval. Take a 3-point lead. Things looking a bit better.
Не надо бить сильно. Это тратишь много сил, и потом непонятно, что из этого выходит. Поэтому отодвигаем, как ты делал, вправо, влево, потом укороченно играет. Она будет на сетку. Сразу играем назад. Не надо ничего повторять на сетке. У нее сейчас здесь вот хорошо получается, да? И у тебя в защите все получается хорошо.
Пробить не нужно.
Well, there's a sudden shift in momentum just before the interval with Zaitseva picking up a few points. Oh, there's an answer straight up from Pemenova. One of the shots of the match. Didn't look to be room there, but Zaitseva just a bit slower to get back to the middle. She paused. And Pemenova spotted the area to play to.
Thank you. Natalia. 9-11. Play.
What a disappointing way to end such a high-quality rally with a lazy shot from Zaitseva. Not lazy, but maybe tired. That's fairer. They, again, have spent some gas on that rally. Having established a 3-point lead, it's disappearing. Back comes Pemenova. There's nothing between these two. Again, a misjudgment on the Zaitseva drop shot. That's good.
Service over, 12-11.
Just what Zaitseva would have wanted, an easy point to retake the lead. Forced error rate is climbing for Zaitseva.
Service over, 12-12. Oh,
what a backhand. Well, Zaitseva absolutely leapt into a couple of those smashes mid-rally. And then that classy backhand of Permanova's that we've been enjoying throughout the match. She's done it again. That flick of the wrist. My goodness, that's a classy shot. That will take the wind out of your sails every time. And that's why Zaitseva's been trying to keep away from it. If she goes to that side, not give her time to hit it. Oh, she's not rolled 30. The ankle there. Permanova's hit the lead. Zaitseva tweaks the ankle. Tests it. All right, on we go.
Service over.
Well, this is a seriously good match. Stern look from Alicia Zaitseva's coach. Just wants to hit a couple. Is the custom with the new racket.
Thank you.
That'll do.
14-0.
Oh, it's dropped in. No, it hasn't. Yes, it has.
15-40.
There was a call, but it wasn't from the line judge. I think it was from either Zaitseva or Permanova wanting it to be in or out, depending on who they were. And it favours Permanova. It dropped in. Point lead is a worrying lead when you're trailing this late in the second game, and you've dropped the first. Permanova 21-19 and 16-14. It's 17-14, and Zaitseva is in trouble.
Service over.
many of these rallies can they stage and still be able to chase the shuttle?
18:40.
I'll need a nice bath and an intravenous drip after this one. So it was called out, and Perminova thinks that might have dropped in. So we'll have a look at this one. The players will gratefully have a drink. I won't get to see it on that angle in any case. So a bit of a pause in proceedings here. Zaitseva really needs it out.
Challenge
it was
unsuccessful. Natalia Perminova has one challenge remaining. Service over. 15-18.
Zaitseva sucking in the oxygen. Needs to win a couple of points on serve here as they change the shuttle once more.
Play.
Shot.
16-18.
Well, there's just fantastic stamina from both Perminova and Zaitseva. They're continuing to entertain us with this great quality. Game's on the line. Perminova just needs 3 points. Zaitseva fighting on. So that one's called in, and Zaitsev is going to have a challenge. So she needs this out. Blessing these breaks. Certainly the players want to get the oxygen in their lungs. They don't want to lose concentration. It's been about 40 seconds already. At times it takes a little while to fire up the technology required to assess it. Plenty, which it has been. Zaitseva refusing to get flustered. Crowd wants a decision. Now she thinks it's funny. So does Perminova. They do have a delightful manner about them, both of them. It's been played in the best of spirits. Finally, we will get a call, and it's in. Is it worth the wait?
Has no challenges remaining. No. Service over, 19-16.
Play. So we resume. Perminova just needs a couple. Won't get one there. Great smash Service from Zaitseva, who's digging in.
19. Thank you. Seventeen, 19.
Oh, 10 reflexes. Perminova and a presenter with match point.
Service over. 20, match point, 17.
Another change of shuttle. Actually requested by Zaitseva, but it's Perminova who has the serve. And it's in. Well, a quick end to a long match. And I hope you'd agree with me, it was played in the very finest of spirits and at the very top end of the game. There was and they're still chuckling about that very long challenge. I do so much enjoy seeing players still enjoying the game at this elite level. So much seems to hang on results. So much pressure attached to elite level sport. When you see the athletes enjoying themselves, even finding moments of fun in international competition, then it's quite encouraging, really. But it's a result for Perminova in the end, 21-19, 21-17. She has beaten Alicia Zaitseva of Belarus.